Good morning, dear students. How are you all? Today I thought of recapitulating evolution of psychology with you. In my last PowerPoint presentation and lecture, I had discussed the various schools of thought. I thought that I would once again take up this topic so that there is no confusion and you're absolutely clear about it, because it is a very, very important topic from your examination point of view and also from your knowledge point of view, because you should know how psychology has evolved over a period of time through these schools of thought. Let me take them up one by one. The first school of thought, known as structuralism, this is the oldest approach to psychology. You know, students, it was proposed by Wilhelm Wundt, and structuralists were interested in analysis of human mind and its components and its structure. That is why the name structuralism. They were interested in conscious experience and wanted to study the building blocks of mind. That means what constitute the mind. So they used introspection as a method to study mental processes and experiences. Coming to the second school of thought, which is functionalism. It is an approach to psychology developed by American psychologist William James. These people, known as functionalists, emphasized on what the mind does and how behavior functions. According to them, consciousness, unlike or in contrast to structuralism, is an ongoing mental process. You cannot break it down into parts. They also used introspection as a method to study mental processes and experiences. But they focused on what mind does and how behavior functions. So that is why the name functionalism. Coming to the next school of thought, which is Gestalt psychology. Gestalt psychology had thinkers like Wertheimer, Kafka and Kohler. It was founded in Germany by these psychologists who were known as Gestalt psychologists. It says whole is more than the sum of its parts. Now what does it mean? When we look at the world, the organization of what we see, that is called perceptual organization. And they also demonstrated the laws of perceptual organization. So the organization of what we see is viewed as a whole and not as the sum of its parts. For example, when we look at a table, we do not see the four wooden legs and the trapezoid surface separately. We recognize this as a table. So our perceptual experience is more than the sum of the components of perceptions. That is, we give meaning to perception. So we see things as a whole rather than breaking up into parts. For example, a flowers or birds flying against the sky. So we treat these things as a whole. Coming to the next school of thought, which is known as behaviorism. Now, behaviorism was proposed by John B. Watson, who viewed psychology as a science of behavior. And behavior is something which can be described objectively in terms of a stimuli and a response. You know, every stimuli leads to a response. For example, suddenly if we announce an examination during your normal school hours, you will start developing anxiety and you will immediately sit down with your notebooks and study. Or when you see a wild animal, you will run for your life. So every stimuli leads to a response. This approach proposed that concepts like consciousness, image, mind, you cannot measure them. You cannot study them objectively or with a scientific logic. What you can study is known as behavior, which is observable and which is verifiable. So here he was influenced by Pavlov's classical conditioning and was interested in the study of learning. The next school of thought that we are going to deal with, well, you are going to study about it in detail again in class 12th, that is called psychodynamic approach. And Dr. Sigmund Freud was the father of psychoanalysis, who viewed human behavior as a dynamic manifestation of unconscious desires and conflicts, which we are not aware at present. So he wanted to understand and cure psychological disorders by using psychoanalysis. Well, it is a technique where, it is an approach where he used two techniques, free association and dream interpretation. The patient is asked to freely think and associate one thought with the other. That is called free association. There is no, limitation. There is no boundary which is set that, okay, you cannot express these kind of thoughts. Whatever comes to his mind, he is allowed to express, and the concerned person or the psychologist is able to trace the problem to the experiences of his childhood. Similarly, dreams are also very much considered as a symbol of unfulfilled desires and conflicts. So we will take up this particular school in detail in the chapter of personality in class 12. Next I come to is the humanistic approach. This particular approach was basically advocated by Carl Rogers and Abraham Maslow. They emphasized on the free will of human beings. They said that people are free to do whatever they choose to do. Their actions are not predetermined by any force. Human beings strive to grow and unfold their potential. That is, every human being always wants to grow in life because we are fully functioning people. If we lose the goal and purpose and direction in our life, we will become completely cut off from the society. We will not be able to find out that why we are living. So we need to know what is our potential. As a human being, as a student, you should know what is your inner potential and how you can achieve the best in life. So one must have a goal in life and one must make his life worthwhile. The next school of thought is the cognitive perspective or constructivism. It is a combination of Gestalt and structuralist approach, and it is more or less treated in the contemporary psychology of today. It focuses on cognition, that is, how we know the world through thinking, understanding, perceiving, memorizing, problem solving. Now, in this particular school of thought, Jean, Piaget and Vygotsky, they are the pioneers of this thought. Cognitive psychology say that human mind is an information processing system like a computer. Mind is considered to receive, process, transform, store and retrieve the information. That means our mind, first of all, receives the stimuli, processes it, gives it a particular shape that is called transformation, stores it, and you recall the information as and when required. So it is like a computer. Our human mind is very, very dynamic. And human beings, we constantly construct our minds as they interact with the physical and social environment and because of the interaction between adults and children. So that is how you construct the world around you. This is called constructivism. So with this, I would like to end my presentation here today, students. I hope with this recapitulation lecture, you have been able to understand the evolution of psychology better. If you have any kind of problems, you are most welcome to get back to me. Thank you and have a good day.